Hi, I'm Kenneth Wajda. I'm a professional photographer here in Colorado. Welcome to another one of my on the road photo talk, photo walk series, where I go out with the big 4x5 camera. Maybe one of these times I'll use the Rolleiflex, but the 4x5 camera typically, and we go around and we shoot one iconic photo of each of the downtowns near me. And last time we were in Berthoud, Colorado. Today we're going to a town that is very, very popular around Valentine's Day. In fact, a lot of people send their mail to be postmarked their Valentine's love letters from this town because it's called Loveland, Colorado. And Loveland is a cool little town with a great downtown. Their downtown just revitalized a little bit, and they built up a big complex with a new movie theater and a new restaurant area and a new town square. But we're probably not going to use that because the downtown that is their old downtown, their classic downtown, is beautiful. And it has a historic movie theater called the Rialto Theater right in the center of town. And I think we're going to want to use that for part of the photograph. And then the question is, what camera do I use? I might take the Ebony and shoot with an ultra wide if I wanted to get some kind of a foreground with cars. There's a lot of angled parking in that town. Or I might take the Wista and shoot with a 150 or a 210, depending on whether I need to get a longer reach. That Ebony is really good for wide angle. It's the SW45. So those are choices. And really, we don't know until we get up there and set up the camera and take a look. But it's a treat to go out and photograph these towns and have this goal of making this series of photographs. So I look forward to going up there, and we have a beautiful day. The town sits on the main drag, main street goes east to west. So at sunset, we should get some good light coming down through across the town. If I'm thinking of it the way I'm thinking of it, backlit, if I'm standing on the east side, maybe it would be a really cool shot. And in any case, nothing I can plan can be completely planned. We have to go up there and find out by going up and finding out. So let's get in the car. Let's grab the gear, put on your hat, and let's head out to Loveland, Colorado. All right, so we're in the car. We're heading to Loveland, Colorado. It's a beautiful little town. It's kind of a biggish town. It has a downtown that's several blocks long, and it's got restaurants. And if ever you're in Colorado, that would be a good place to visit. It's certainly little bookstores, little antique shops, which I like those things. There's a good thrift store. And they have good brew pubs. I love a good craft beer. I'm a big IPA fan. And since we're driving, I'll tell you a little story about IPAs, India Pale Ales. Did you know that an India Pale Ale is named for the English had colonized India? And when they did, they would take beer up there and it would go bad. And as it would go bad, they would say, we've got to do something to keep it from going bad. Add some more hops. And so they added more hops. And it would still go bad. So they added more hops. And when they found the right amount of hops that actually kept it from spoiling, then they called it the India Pale Ale. And we still call it the India Pale Ale. I like that. Anyway, we're about 30 minutes, 25 minutes from town, so I'll see you when we get there. We'll unpack the gear and we'll take a look at what we have. The town is in shade, and it's all reflected light from this side hitting that side. So we can shoot here. We're not going to have real drastic bright light, but we will have a good fill light because the sun that's right here for a little while longer, but not too long. I better be quicker, then I might lose that light. Once this light leaves here, then the whole scene is in sort of this flat post sunset light. Even though it's still 2 hours before sunset, or maybe an hour and a half before sunset, if it goes behind the building, as far as this town's concerned, we're in it. Okay, so this is full sun on me, but this is, I think, my shot. And I'll show you why it's from here I have to do it. So I'm putting the camera onto the base. I'm opening the camera. It automatically locks at 90, which I like that about this camera. Bring up the front standard. Bring it forward pretty much. Now it's got a 150 on it. So the question is the 150 what I want? And the reason I want to shoot here is because I'm trying to get, I'll show you in a second, the sign of the foreground with the background. Like I said, I have to go work kind of quickly because if this sun leaves here, which it's going to do in a very short while, there won't be a shot. To back up a little bit if I want to use this lens to get this shot. Everything's about fine-tuning. So I'm kind of working quickly because, like I said, I'm going to lose this light, and if this light goes, I'm done. So I would like to shift the lens a little bit. And I thought this lens had shift on it, but does it? Or does this camera only have tilt and swing? And it has back shift. I remember it has back shift. This camera, you have to shift the back if you want to shift it. So I need to do that because I'm not quite getting the framing I'm looking for. It's interesting how you remember things when you are working with something. Yeah, I think this lens is a little bit long. I got to go to the 70 to the 90. So we'll quick pull this off. We'll put this 90 on. Wow, it's in a case with red velvet. There's like all this red velvet all over this. I don't like that too much. The nice thing about the ebony boards is they interchange with the Wista boards. So you can use either one on either camera. I really like that. This is nice because this has a foreground of the ceiling of the area where I'm near. So like I did in the shot in Berthoud, a little bit of front rise or fall, bring that down a little bit. And then here, ever so slightly, I want to tilt backwards because I want something that's above me and the background. So I want to ever so slightly, I want to tilt this camera so that the base tilt is up a little bit. So now I'll go behind the camera and take a look. It feels like I'm getting flare in the camera. It feels like there's something flaring in the camera. Either that or these bellows, which are a little crinkled, are blocking the view. I'm going to get rid of the tilt for a second and take a look at it without that. I'm not sure what that is. I haven't seen that before. It looks like as if you almost drew like a white circle around the outside of the viewfinder. Let's see, maybe I can get you to see it. You can kind of see it at the top edge of this. There's a
almost like a ring. You can kind of see it there. I've never seen that before. So I'll probably choose to go with the 150 and make it work.
This is probably my favorite lens, this little 150, because it's so little and it's so well made and it works so well. And now I definitely don't see that. So it definitely must have been something to do with that lens on this camera, which I've used on this camera before, I think. So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to get some of the foreground of this building to work so that you can get a sense of this side of the street and that side of the street. So now I need to drop this a little bit or raise it up a little bit. See, there's a sign that says collectible that I'm trying to get into the corner of the frame. So now I have this side of the street in the foreground and that side in the background. So all I have to do is focus, get a meter reading, and make the photo. And we have to work quickly because we're going to run out of time. So I'm taking the cable release and we're putting that into the camera now. So we'll be ready. Sometimes you have to work on the quick. Okay, that looks really good. Now to just make sure it's level, because remember this camera has a tendency, or this tripod has a tendency to be a little bit off level, and we want a level photo. So now we have our light meter and we can do an incident reading. If we do it here, we're probably going to be too bright because the light that's here is a lot brighter coming off of this sunny wall than it is across the street. So I'm going to take a walk into the street, take a quick reading. I'll be right back. So I just did a reading and it comes out to a half a second at 45 and a half in the shady area. But there is some sun in the scene, so I have to be careful. I'm probably going to go with a half a second at 64 and trust that by stopping down a little bit, I won't blow out the sun too much. And you can get away with a little bit of the blowout on the sun side because film is very forgiving and hard to blow out, unlike digital. So now all we have to do is put this video camera out of the way of the picture, which is right in the way, and then make the shot. So you can see that sun line is what I'm using for a bounce light off of this place, but I gotta make sure I don't go too late or else I'll miss it. So now it's time to shoot. Make sure the lens is closed. Fire the shutter. Test to make sure it's closed. It's closed. Put the film in. Now watch how easily this one goes in. And I have to make sure I have the right film. This is the right film. Bergger 400. White side is out on both sides. So both of these holders is loaded. So watch, see how easy that is? It just comes right out. And see how smoothly that goes in? That's what I love about this Wista. It's like the ebony I fight, this one I don't bite. So all we have to do, double check. Dark slide comes out. And there are some people coming, so the question is, do I shoot now? I'm trying to think. I don't think they're in my field of view at the moment. I don't want to lose the sun, but if they were to walk close to the foreground, they just might be ahead, which I'm not sure I want that either. But we'll see. Here comes somebody crossing the street. And I'm good. I'm just looking for what might be the right person or the right element to add to the photo and make it alive. And I think here it comes right now. Now they were moving as a half a second. We'll see if it works out. But you gotta shoot something and try it. That's the beauty of photography. You're working it, you're trying it. All right, that's the shot. There it is. Time to take it to the lab, see what we got. You can see how that was a challenging one. Light was changing. I was going to lose all of the ambient light. All the ambient light that's bouncing onto that side is from this side. But as soon as that sun goes down, we have none. And we need some good reflected light sometimes. That's the one thing about small towns is sometimes you have these narrow stretches with tall buildings. You don't get to work till sunset. So let's go process this. We'll see what we have and we'll do a recap back at the studio. So you can see how that was a challenging one. I had light that was fleeting. I had an idea for a photograph that I really couldn't get, maybe unless I could have used the ebony. If I had more time, I might have put the ebony up to see if that camera with the 90 would have been a better, it would have maybe not had that problem with the flaring circle. I'm not sure what that is. I'll have to look that up and see if I can figure out what that is and talk about it in the recap. But then at the end, there were people coming through. And the question is, you know, you're shooting at a half a second. Are you really going to get anybody to not look like a blur? And is that okay if they do look like a blur? So this is a good shoot, but difficult and challenging. And I really like the frame and it'll be interesting to see what it looks like in the final photograph. And I always like working with that Wista. The Wista is such a, just it works really well. I really like the way it feels. And it feels like the wood is super smooth. It's a used camera, so somebody has used it a lot. And it feels like this wood is all, it's just been polished by lots of years of use. So I feel like it's a treat to have the ability to shoot that. And it's my favorite camera, so. All right, we'll figure out what that looks like and see what the picture looks like. That's the thing that matters most. But the process sure is fun getting there. Okay, so here is the photograph from Loveland, and I love the fact that there is this one element that I was watching for to make sure I got a piece of it in the frame, and that's that little sculpture between the cars of the movie cameraman, because that sits out in front of the Rialto Theater across the street. That was mainly my focus, as I needed to get that theater into a shot. And it's a very historic theater, but the front facade doesn't have that great marquee look. It looks like a pretty low-key building, but it's a beautiful theater inside. They probably have gone through some changes, and I wonder if they did have a marquee at one point. But that's a photograph that is so... I love the fact that that sculpture is there next to and is a part of it. I did not see that vehicle coming through the frame. And I actually like the fact that it's in motion, just like those people who are perfectly placed. There's subject motion. There's a sense of vitality to the point that they're actually moving through the frame while we're making this photograph. They're looking inside of a store. They're in hard sun, so they're super contrasty. But the film could hold the detail, and the exposure looks good, the negative looks good. I really like that photo, and I think that that shoot went well. I did research about that white ring light that I was seeing, and I didn't find anything. And I wonder if anybody knows anything about what I was seeing there. And my thought is, if I see it in the viewfinder or on the ground glass, it's going to be in the photograph. What is on that ground glass is what the film will see. So I wasn't going to just shoot it anyway, but as we were working, that was an example of time is sometimes working against you. If you're waiting to get the shot, but you need to work before the light is gone. elements are working against you. The technical, that lens was in my way. And then finally, I was able to back the camera up, use the 150, and make the shot. And I like the way it turned out. I think that's a good representation of Loveland. I always enjoy when I'm in a town to put a little bit of the foreground, especially if there's cool awnings, into my frame so that that gives us a sense of depth. This gives us the here and the there versus all there. Just like if you're shooting nature, as an example, a lot of times you'll see people put wildflowers in the foreground and then they put the mountains in the background. It's the here and there. It's not enough to just have the there or just the here sometimes. It's nice to have both so that you get the sense of depth. And that photo really shows depth because it has that foreground with the collectible sign. There's a little antique shop there that you probably saw a woman working in while we were setting up. If it were possible, there's a part of me that thought, boy, it would have been interesting to use a 75 ultra wide and get her in the frame. Somebody working inside, people passing outside and the outside, but that probably wasn't going to happen yesterday when I was working on that short amount of time. But I like the way the final photo came out, and thanks for coming along with me and working through the issues came up. That's the process that we make when we go and make large format photographs and work the scene to get it the exact way you want it. All right, I'll see you next time on the road.